Welcome back for episode 2 in this series of tutorials for PCG. Last video, we saw how to generate a simple forest with different meshes, and in this episode, we are going to see exactly the utility of pound bounds that will help us exclude points from another set of points. It would be useful to add more meshes, like rocks or some foliage, to have a better looking forest, while not spawning them overlapping other meshes. We'll also see how to measure the performance of the graph generation and how to organize the graph. Let's jump right into it. So this is the result that we had last time. We left off the last episode with a rule containing three nodes. The first one was taking the landscape and sampling points on the surface. Then we applied random transformation on the scale and the rotation. And then we were spawning different meshes with different probabilities, different trees. Talking about meshes, the rock and foliage that I will be using for this episode are taken from some megascans. The first one is Megascan Forest Undergrowth with the rocks. The second one is the Megascan Tree European Beech for this little foliage on the ground. But you can use any meshes you want, of course. So we'll first try to add rocks, and to do so, we will need to sample more points. To make it clearer, in the beginning, I will just disable the trees. Well, remove the trees, just to make sure to remember that these ones are the nodes that generate the trees. I will add a comment, so I'll right click and create comment from selection, add set of trees, and put it in green, because trees are green. So we'll do the same thing that we do for the trees. We're going to take the landscape height and then create a surface sampler node. Then we will enable the debug information to see the results of our generation. Then we'll add some randomness, same thing, transform points. And we'll still apply random rotation. Let's debug the transform node to see it. And then for the scale, I'm just going to do a big scale with boxes, a lot of boxes. So by making big scales, you can see that you have a lot of boxes that are overlapping. So if I try to add the rocks, to spawn the rocks with the static mesh spawner, I will add a new mesh entry, which is my rock. And then remove the debug. You can see that we have a lot of rocks. If I zoom in, you can see that some are overlapping pretty close to each other. We have way too many rocks there, which is not what we want. So we have two problems there. First one, if we are enabling the debug information on the transform points, you can see that the boxes, which represent the bounds, are not respecting the final shape of the mesh. And then the second problem is that with transform points, we have overlapping boxes, so we need to remove all the overlaps to avoid these mesh collisions. So the debug information is helping us a lot there. Let's try to fix our first problem. So for the first one, we need to change our bounds. We have multiple ways to do so. You can change the extent of the surface sampler, for example. So if I go to the surface sampler and set that this one is 150, you will see that the boxes are more rectangular shape now. But changing the extent of the surface sampler has side effects. Sometimes we want to have bigger extent when sampling because you don't want the points to be too close from each other. So we'll just put it back. And then we will add a new node. This node is called the bounds modifier. So we will add it between the transform points and the static mesh spawner. By default, it's doing nothing, so you will see exactly the same debug information. As you can see, it is using the scale mode, so it means that we're going to scale our bounds. We have different modes, like intersect, set, include, but we will just focus on scale for now. You can try yourself if you want to. So because the bounds are bigger than our final mesh, we want to try to reduce them by half. So let's set the bounds to 0.5 everywhere. So you can see that the boxes are smaller now. And we can start to see the final mesh poking outside of the box. Because our final mesh is not really a cube, we are going to set the bounds a bit smaller for on the x-axis. Like 0.45, and then a bit longer on the y-axis, 0.6 from both sides. And yeah, it's better. The box are encapsulating the mesh pretty well now, which is way better. But we can see that we have still boxes that overlaps each other. So for that, we are going to add another node that is called the self-pruning node. So I will add it between the bounce modifier and the static mesh pruner. And if I remove the debug information, you can see that we don't have any more rocks that are intersecting with each other. If I put debug information on the bounds modifier and the self-pruning, you can see that if I disable this one, we have boxes that are removed. So the current pruning type is large to small. It means that we are prioritizing the large boxes. If I go the other way around, small to large, we will have more small boxes. And there are multiple nodes, you can play a bit with them, but we'll keep with large to small. So we have another generator for rocks, which is working pretty well. So we're gonna reorganize a bit the graph. So I'm going just to select everything. I can also press the C key to add a comment. And then we'll say rocks. I will do it like light gray, because my rocks are gray. Okay, so we have now our rocks, and then we will re-add our trees. And let's play a bit to see what's going on. So yeah, that was expected. Without any constraint between the rocks and the trees, we can find rocks that are inside all the trees, which is not good. So now we want to make sure that the trees are not overlapping the rocks. So we need to make sure that the bounds of the trees are good. So let's go back to our graph and let's enable debug on the static mesh folder for the trees, and we can zoom in. So as you can see that we have boxes that are bigger than the trees, but that's okay. We can live with that. You can use a bounds modifier to make it more narrow if you want to, but for the sake of this example, it will be enough. So right now, we want to make sure the trees are not intersecting with the rocks. Let's introduce the new node, the difference node. So what we want is we want to exclude the points that are from our rocks, the source, from the trees, and our differences. So let me explain a bit more what's going on behind the scene. With the source point cloud, which are our rock, it's doing the projection on the trees, on the other point cloud. What the projection means in this case, between two point clouds with bounds, is that it will just try for each point in the source, find all the points that are overlapping on the other point cloud. And if we are using the density function binary, which is the simplest one, it means that if projections succeed, meaning that for one source point, we found points that overlaps on the difference point cloud, it will be discarded. So if I disable the mesh pruner, disable the rocks too, and then let's see the self-pruning and the difference, you can see that without the self-pruning debug information, we are removing a lot of points. The other ones are a bit more complicated. I won't go into much into the details. So we will stick with binary now. And from there, let's re-enable our trees. Let's re-enable our rocks, disable the debug information, then press play, and let's look at the rocks. So yeah, we have rocks, and it's no more intersecting with the trees. We have no more trunks into the rocks, which is cool. All right, final touch now. Let's add foliage. I have this very simple mesh that will scatter all around volumes, and again, without colliding with the trees and the rocks. So let's try to disable the trees and rock meshes and add a new sub-assembler. So I go back to my graph. I will disable the trees and the rocks. And I will add a new sub-assembler. What I will do is drag my landscape height, the sub-assembler, and then I have my sub-assembler already connected to the right thing. I press debug to see it. So our foliage will be much fuller and we want a lot of them. So let's try to reduce our point extent. So we put that 10 everywhere to have small boxes. We want the points to be close to each other, so reduce the looseness. And then we will add a lot of them with 5. To know exactly the number of points, we can inspect the surface sampler. And you can see that we have like close to 50k points, which is a lot. We do exactly the same thing as the other one, and we're going to use transform points to add randomness. We still want to have our rotation around Z, but perhaps we can have some rotation around the Y and X axis. Not too much because we don't want it to hover over the ground. And then we can scale it a bit more. Like we can do 90% and 110%. And yeah, we're just going to debug the transform points. And that's what we have. We have more points like this, but we still have the boxes that are perhaps a bit too close. So let's use the bounce modifier to reduce the bounce. So I will debug this one instead. I don't know, put 0.5. We don't really care about the Z axis. So yeah, a lot of small boxes like this. At this point, I want to warn you, if you try to spawn that many meshes in one go, it can take a bit long, depends on your CPU. So wait a bit to see how we can mitigate the cost of spawning, but me, I would just YOLO it. So let's add the static mesh spawner, connect the bounds, remove the bound modifier, and then we can add our mesh, which would be this one. Boom. Lots and lots of foliage everywhere. So as I said, it's depending a lot on your CPU. You can wait a bit when generating that many points and spawning everything. And the main problem with static mesh spawning is that it's done on the main thread, so we cannot multi-thread it. So we are kind of stuck to spawn them at once. To see exactly the cost of the static mesh spawner, we can open the profiling. I will just clean up by volume. I will open the profiling window, and then I will press generate. And then you can see you have your static mesh spawner that's taking 250 milliseconds to spawn, which is a lot. Is it possible to reduce that number? The answer is yes, because what is very costly in this case, when you are spawning a lot of meshes, is to spawn them with collision. So for that kind of foliage, you don't want collision, or you don't need collision. So it's okay to go through them, at least for this demo. So we'll change the parameter. So if I go back to the collision preset, and I can set it to no collision, and then the change is instantaneous. You can see that now spawning the meshes costs 4 milliseconds instead of 250, which is a huge boost. So now I will just clean up my graph. I would say this one are the grass, that then grass are green, so we put green there. Then we can re-enable our trees or rocks. Can press save and press play. And yeah, you have a lot of foliage everywhere, but same thing that with our rocks, that we have foliage that is inside the trees, that we have foliage that are inside the rocks, which is not ideal. So let's fix that. So what we want to do is the same thing, add a difference node, and we want to remove from the points of the grass, we want to remove the trees and the rocks, and then we can change it to binary to exclude all overlapping boxes, reconnect the foliage, press save and press play. And now you have it. The foliage is around the rocks, it's around the trees, but never overlapping with them. And then you have it. Our forest became a bit more interesting to navigate into. And as always, it's also possible to generate at runtime. So if I just clean up and press play, everything is generated when the world is loaded, which is pretty cool. And that concludes our second episode of the series. I hope you enjoyed this one. And next episode, we're going to see how to sample our meshes instead of the landscape, and since it seems to be a much requested feature. Until then, have fun with the plugin and take care.